I'm Bob Rubin, co-chairman of the Council of Foreign Relations. We're at the annual corporate conference of the Council, and I'm honored to have with us distinguished visiting fellow of the Council of Foreign Relations, Michael Spence, who is a Nobel laureate in economics. We're going to have a brief conversation. Michael, why don't we start with this question? You've done a lot of work on the demand for capital in the emerging market world and savings rates. What would your judgment be about the cost of capital in the years and, say, the decade to come?
Well, it looks very much like the growth in the emerging markets, Bob, is going to produce a boom in investment in infrastructure, cities, you know, businesses all over the world, but especially in the rapidly growing emerging markets. And that they've gotten big enough, so they're going to reverse the sort of downward trend that we've had in the post-war period in sort of investment as a fraction of global GDP. And only now the GDP is pretty big, so we're talking about big numbers. So that looks fairly certain. I mean, something would have to go badly wrong with the emerging market growth for that not to happen. Saving side is a little more complicated and patchwork. You know, on the one hand, we're aging and saving less. On the other hand, emerging markets tend to save more, and they're growing. Hard to know, but probably the best guess, the one that McKinsey made in their study of all of this, was that savings would be struggling to keep up with investment, and we probably see a rise in the cost of capital.
Does that mean, Michael, that on a global basis, that we'd have higher interest rates, and then however you want to measure the cost of equity capital, a higher cost of equity capital, lower PE ratios or something of that sort?
Yeah, that would be the implication of this if it happens. There'd probably be also a fairly pronounced tendency to intervene in international capital flows for a variety of reasons. High debt countries might want to keep the savings that they have at home and put in barriers. The high savings area might want to protect themselves from rising cost of capital and keep that savings at home. So there's all kinds of questions having to do with protectionism in the financial sense, intermediation, efficient cross-border flows, and so on, that these issues, they get raised by this trend.
What happens how do you factor cyclical factors into this?
This is sort of a longer term thing. So I think on a cyclical basis, it looks like, you know, we're in for a period led by us in America of lower interest rates, you know, with a fragile recovery. This wouldn't overcome that. But after we're through that period, it looks like these longer term forces will kick in.
Michael, let's turn to another subject. I know you've done a tremendous amount of, I think, really interesting work, which is going to be published in Foreign Affairs, at least a piece of it is going to be, with respect to the structure of the American economy, the changes that are taking place, and the implications for growth and for income distribution. Why don't you tell us what conclusions you've drawn from that?
Bob, we looked at the last couple of decades of job creation and value creation, if you like. The economic term is value added. In the American economy, value added, if you run across industries and add it up, supposed to come out to the GDP. So it's a way of not double counting, I guess. What we found is that most of the job creation was in the part of the economy that doesn't trade internationally, goods and services that have to be produced at home if they're going to be consumed at home. Things like government, healthcare, retail, construction, for the most part. There's a few exceptions in any of these little things, but and the job creation in the tradable sector was pretty negligible over these two decades. And so we created 27 million jobs and pretty much absorbed those people without having an unemployment problem in the non-tradable side of the economy. I think if you look at value, it's a very different picture. The tradable side is growing in not in employment, but in value creation, actually a little bit faster than the other side. So it looks to me and my co-author Sandile Halachwayo that we're about to have a divergence between growth and employment. The growth looks like, you know, once we get out of this deep shock that the economy suffered, looks like it's there. There's very healthy parts of the tradable sector, multinational enterprises, finance, and so on, that are playing in a global environment, you know, high degree of competitiveness, doing very well. The manufacturing sectors are also doing well, but the lower value-added parts of the manufacturing sectors, you know, where middle-income people work or used to, are moving offshore. So structurally, that appears to be what's happening. Now, best guess, I mean, nobody knows for sure. Best guess is if we're right about this divergence, we'll have an unemployment problem that's more stubborn than anyone hopes, and that eventually those markets clear and we'll have a challenge in terms of income distribution, where the people in the middle income category and down will be kind of faced with fewer employment opportunities because of the sort of rising size and competitiveness of the emerging markets. And I'm not sure we can absorb them all in the tradable sector without putting a fairly firm lid on wage increases.
So when you wind up with all that, Michael, and looking past the short term, as you said a moment ago, does that take you to a place where unemployment goes back? The norms of unemployment, whatever that might have been prior to the crisis, the recent crisis, we go back to those norms, but we have real wage problems and real distribution problems, and I think we've had stagnant median real wages for 30 years or thereabouts.
Yeah.
So we continue to have that kind of a problem with an ever smaller group doing better and better?
Looks like it. Unless there's ways to sort of expand the scope of the tradable sector and make it a place where more people can work. But there's a set of open questions about that. But yeah, I think that's the best guess.
And if you had to try to, if the president came to you and said, this is what we're facing, Michael, are there any policy ideas that would work? Or are there any policy ideas that might come out of the political processes around that you think we ought not to get involved with on either side of that equation? What would you say?
Well, there's all kinds of things that you can do that are dumb in the area of industrial policy, but I don't think we can just, on the political side and social side, sit idly back. So I'd probably put item one, tax reform, simplification, you know, not creating incentives to leave earnings offshore and invest it there. You know, I mean, it's not even quite a level playing field now. So I think that's important for lots of reasons, including this one. Then we'll go after education and infrastructure. And maybe we ought to sort of have another look at the way we invest our public sector funds on the sort of technology base, you know, of the economy. And I think you'd do that in collaboration with the business community. You'd say, look, we understand the global economy is efficient. You're going where the markets and the supply chain opportunities are. There's nothing wrong with that. It's created an enormous amount of good for millions of people around the world. But we've got a bit of a challenge here. And we're prepared to invest alongside or something and try to create, at the margin, maybe in advanced manufacturing or engineering industries, you know, a bit of an expanded set of opportunities for our own people and experiment.
What would you do as a final question? What would you do in that respect? You said that industrial policy is not where you would go.
In the sense of sort of, you know, this is the sector that, you know, we've decided
right.
is going to win.
So if you didn't do that, what would you do a little more specifically if you have any thoughts? For example, in advanced manufacturing, are there things the government could do that would promote advanced manufacturing?
Well, what I'm going to do is go and look at other advanced countries that are, you know, are differently configured from us and sort of try to learn a little bit. No country's policies, you know, transplant. You can't just imitate what the Germans do or something else. But you can learn something from it. And, you know, there's institutions that get supported. There's skilled labor that gets built up that's a kind of a collective asset in some sense. So that's my instinct, is to go on a kind of learning mission and see what we can find out.
Michael, thank you very much.
Pleasure to be here with you, Bob.